Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome you to another episode of our fascinating and exciting series towards understanding Surah Yusuf. This is your host, Yassir Qadhi. In our previous episode, we had reached the point where the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam reveals himself to his brothers. And the brothers are astonished and shocked that the very minister that they have been dealing with for so many years turns out to be their long-lost brother. In today's episode, we will see how the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam is finally reunited with his parents. Stay with us.
لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And welcome to another episode of our fascinating and exciting series towards understanding Surah Yusuf. We are reaching almost a climax in terms of the story content now. We have just talked about the point in time where the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam reveals his identity to his brothers, and his brothers are absolutely astonished and shocked. In today's episode, inshallah ta'ala, we will continue along and talk about the reunion of Yusuf alayhi salam with his parents. And as is our custom, we will begin with a recitation of the relevant verses. So today we will recite, inshallah ta'ala, from verse number 92 to verse number 98. And I would encourage our viewers to listen and follow along with the Quran in their hands.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم وهو أرحم الراحمين اذهبوا بقميصي هذا فألقوه على وجه أبي يأتي بصيرا وأتوني بأهلكم أجمعين ولما فصلت العير قال أبوهم إني لأجد ريح يوسف قال أبوهم إني لأجد ريح يوسف لولا أن تفندون قالوا تالله إنك لفي ضلالك القديم فلما أن جاء البشير ألقاه على وجهه فارتد بصيرا قال ألم أقل لكم إني أعلم من الله ما لا تعلمون قالوا يا أبانا استغفر لنا ذنوبنا إنا كنا خاطئين قال سوف أستغفر لكم ربي إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.
So in this passage, Yusuf عليه السلام informs them, قال لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. قال لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. He said, no blame is on you today. Notice the phrasing here. He didn't even say, I am not blaming you. Rather, in trying to make it even less personal, trying to make his brothers not feel so singled out, he didn't say, after all that you have done to me, I still forgive you. Rather, he keeps it, as we say, in the neutral. He doesn't mention where the blame will come from. He keeps it anonymous. As he says, لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. There shall be no blame on you. And he does this in order not to hurt his brother's feelings. Look at the perfection in the character of Yusuf alayhi salam. After all that his brothers have done to him, he still does not want to hurt his brothers even in the slightest. And he says, there shall be no blame. Not that I am angry or I have forgiven, not even the slightest hint. There shall be no blame on you today. يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ Allah will forgive you. Now, how could Yusuf alayhi salam say Allah will forgive you when he doesn't know what Allah will do? The response is that because they made their mistake to Yusuf, because they did injustice to Yusuf, then if Yusuf alayhi salam forgives his right, then the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be forgiven if they repent. In other words, to take a step back and to clarify what we're talking about, we can say that any type of sin can be categorized into one of two categories. Any sin that you do is one of two types. The first type of sin is a sin that is done between you and Allah. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows of this, and no one else is affected by it. You have not done anything against another human being. So this is between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for example, if you saw something you should not have seen, if your eyes did something that they should not have done, this is a private sin between you and Allah. In order to have this sin forgiven, you need to repent to Allah. And when you repent, the sin is forgiven. The second category of sin involves a sin that is between you and another person. You steal somebody's money. You say something bad about him. So it involves you and another person. And when it involves you and another person, in this case, you need to seek forgiveness not just from Allah, but also from the person whom you have wronged. So if you have stolen somebody's money, you must ask him forgiveness and ask Allah, because you have transgressed two rights. The rights of Allah, because you stole, and that goes against Allah's commands, and the rights of this person. The rights of the person, you need to ask him directly. The fact that Yusuf alayhi salam is the one who has been wronged, when Yusuf forgives them, then all that is left is the right of Allah, and the right of Allah is always forgiven if you truly repent. And they themselves said, we were mistaken, we made a mistake, inna kunna khati'een. We were people who were in error. So they admitted their guilt and their mistake, and they realized that they did something wrong, and they are going to repent. So that is why Yusuf alayhi salam can be so confident and say, يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ Allah will forgive you, because Yusuf has forgiven and they have repented. And when that is the case, then there is no question that they will be forgiven. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ And he is the most merciful of all those who show mercy. So he is أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ means that even though some people have rahmah, even though some people have mercy, no one can compare to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, Allah is arhamur rahimin. Allah is the most merciful and the most compassionate of all those who have mercy and compassion. Now, what is significant about this verse is that it's very stark reminder of the realities of the revelation of the surah. Remember why this surah was revealed. It was revealed to console our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to tell him that if you think your people have rejected you, how about the Prophet Yusuf, whose own brothers rejected him? Physically, they threw him out. If you think that you have suffered hardship, you are not the first one. Yusuf alayhi salam was only 6-7 years old when the hardships began. So it is a consolation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is also an indication that patience and perseverance will give you the rewards of Allah. Like the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam was patient and persevered. Now, remember, the surah was revealed at the low height of the seerah, if you like, the low depths of the seerah, where it was the most traumatic time for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Yet, when does he use this verse? Amazingly, he uses this very verse at the pinnacle of the incidents of the seerah. قَالَ لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمَ يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ The exact same verse that Yusuf uses at the end of this surah, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam used it at the pinnacle of his prophethood. And when was that? That occurred when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam reconquered Mecca. When he returned to Mecca as a conqueror, the very city that had expelled him, the very city that had persecuted him, the very city that had caused him so much harm and grief and hassle, Now he comes back in the 8th year of the Hijrah, and he comes back leading an army of thousands of Muslims, and he comes back as a conqueror, as a victor, as a person who now controls the entire city. And all the people of Mecca are scared. They are terrified. What will this man do to him, to them, after all they have done to him? They deserve to be executed one man after another. They deserve that they are punished the severest punishment for all that they have done, not just for the last 10, for the last 20 years, the persecution that they have done. So they all come huddled, cowering, scared, terrified around the Kaaba. And the Prophet ﷺ is standing high up, and he says, مَا تَظُنُّنَّ أَنِّي فَاعِلٌ بِكُمْ. What do you think, or perhaps, what is the real thing I should do to you? What is the verdict that you deserve? What do you think I should do to you? So obviously, in that terrified state, in that scared state, all they could do is beg and plead in the best way. And they say, you are our noble relative and the son of a noble relative. In other words, we're all related, we're all family. So they remind him, after all that they have done, after the persecution and torture, after the assassination attempts against him, what can come out of their mouths? Oh, we are all family. We are all one group. We are all from the Quraysh. We all have the same ancestors. You are our cousin, you are our relative, and your parents were also our relatives. So when they said this, and of course the Prophet ﷺ had no intention to punish them, he said the same verse that Yusuf ﷺ said, قَالَ لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمِ. There is no blame on you today. يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Allah will forgive you. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ. And He is the most merciful of all those who show mercy. Then Yusuf alayhi salam says, اِذْهَبُوا بِقَمِيصِ هَذَا. Take this shirt of mine and throw it on the face of my father. He shall return back to seeing and bring your families back to me here in Egypt. So he gives him the shirt. He gives him the shirt that he was wearing and tells the brothers, go back to your father and throw this shirt in his face. When it touches his face, his eyesight will get back to normal. Here we see the motif of the shirt again. The shirt is what the brothers tore off of Yusuf. The shirt is the evidence they gave to their father. The shirt is the very evidence that their father realized Yusuf is alive, because it wasn't torn into bits. And then the shirt was what was torn from Yusuf when the woman tried to seduce him, the wife of Aziz, and the shirt proved his innocence there. And now the theme of the shirt returns at the end, and he tells them, take this qamis, take this garment and shirt of mine, and throw it in my father's face. The very shirt that caused him blindness in the beginning because of the grief, now the shirt will come back and bring his sight back. And this is because the cure of any disease is always the opposite of that disease. So the shirt that caused him to go blind, now another shirt of Yusuf alayhi salam will bring him back to his sight. And obviously we know that the clothes of all of the prophets, anything that is connected to their bodies, it has an intrinsic blessing to it. Anything that the Prophet ﷺ wore, anything that he touched, any water that comes from his hands, all of this would become blessed. And so Yusuf ﷺ gave this shirt, which must have now been a blessed shirt, but this is only for the prophets of Allah. No pious person can say that I am exuding blessings or blessings come from my shirt. No. Only the prophets of Allah are so holy that their very bodies become items that are blessed, and so anything that they wear becomes blessed as well. And so he told them, take the shirt and go throw it on the face of my father, and he shall return to his state of seeing. We need to take a short break now. I know all of you will stay with me. We'll see you in a bit.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
إذا دكت الأرض دكاً.
Do you want to learn how to recite the Quran? Do you want to read Islamic books in Arabic? You may enroll in a small group.
العسل من السوق.
اشترى.
نعم اشترى.
A private lesson.
من مثلها في فضلها.
من مثلها في فضلها.
Or at your own pace to fit your schedule.
هل أنت قارئ في المعهد؟
Courses for sisters with female instructors. we're bringing you the latest software technology, professional instructors, and a state-of-the-art classroom to the comfort of your home. Enroll now in Huda Academy. Huda Academy, your gateway to authentic Islamic knowledge.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back. So Yusuf alayhi salam gives them his shirt and says, "Go back to your father and throw this shirt in his face, and he will return to his sight that he used to see." Allah says in the Quran, وَلَمَّا فَصَلَتِ الْعِيرُ. Then when the caravan departed from Egypt, when the caravan departed from Egypt, قَالَ أَبُوهُمْ, their father said, إِنِّي لَأَجِدُ رِيحَ يُوسُفْ. I am sure I can smell Yusuf. I am sure I can smell Yusuf. The scent of Yusuf, I can smell it. لَوْلَا أَن تُفَنِّدُونَ. Were it not for the fact that you would think that I am now senile and old, I would have said even more. In other words, I am sure I smell the scent of Yusuf, but I know that when I say this, all that you're going to think is that I am an old man who has lost his mind. So all the way from Egypt, when the caravan sets forth, the Prophet Ya'qub alayhi salam is blessed with the sense and perception. Something is happening. I smell my son again. And of course, all of this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with this blessing and this bushra, this good news that Yusuf alayhi salam is about to return. You're about to see him and things are going to change. Of course, when he said this, what do you think his relative said? Now, these are his grandchildren, because all the sons are in Egypt. The grandchildren and the great-grandchildren, they replied back that, قَالُوا تَاللَّهِ إِنَّكَ لَفِي ضَلَالِكَ الْقَدِيمِ. They said, we swear by Allah, you are still in your old ways of misguidance. Misguidance here, again, is not a spiritual misguidance. It is an error that is an intellectual error. It's not an error that is a religious error. Remember, they are all, Ya'qub is a prophet, so they cannot accuse this prophet of being misguided in a religious sense. Rather, they think that he is mistaken in when he thinks that Yusuf alayhi salam is returning. And this shows us that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses certain people with things that he does not bless others with, and especially the prophets, obviously, they are blessed with matters that the other people are not blessed with. So they dismiss this and they say, you are indeed in your errorful ways. You cannot possibly be smelling Yusuf alayhi salam. Rather, just like all of these years, all you can do is think of Yusuf. Now once again you are saying the same thing, but now it's a twist. And the twist is, you think you can smell Yusuf. So they dismiss this prophet's sayings as being that of an old man ranting away. They don't appreciate the fact that this is the Prophet Ya'qub alayhi salam and the knowledge that Allah has given him. So they trivialize the status of Ya'qub simply because he is their father and grandfather. قَالُوا تَاللَّهِ إِنَّكَ لَفِي ضَلَالِكَ الْقَدِيمِ. فَلَمَّا أَنْ جَاءَ الْبَشِيرُ. Then when the Bashir came, and the Bashir here refers to one of the brothers, and Allah calls him Bashir, not that his name was Bashir, but it's a description. It means the one who bore the good tidings, the one who came with the good news. And that is why even the Prophet ﷺ is called a Bashir in the Quran, because he gives us good news of Allah's mercy. He gives us good news of Allah's pleasure. He gives us good news of the hereafter. So even the Prophet ﷺ is called Bashir. Some of the scholars say that the very brother who was the most evil of them before, and the one who was the most sinister in wanting to kill Yusuf in the beginning of the story, that brother turned over completely and realized the error of his ways, and he insisted on bringing the shirt back to his father. And this is something that, inshallah ta'ala, is not far from the truth, because all of the brothers repented from what they had done. So the one that was the worst of them in terms of the plotting and planning, he became the most repentant, and he was the one who came and he insisted to bring the shirt to their father because of all of the crimes that he had done. And he threw the shirt in the face of Ya'qub alayhi salam, and miraculously, by the pleasure and the mercy and the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the eyesight of Ya'qub was restored, because the eyesight of Ya'qub had gone blind because of the excessive crying that he had done for the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. And at this point he said, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكُمْ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. He said, didn't I tell you that I know from Allah what you don't know? He is a prophet of Allah. He is a prophet, and they did not appreciate that. Not that they didn't realize, no, of course they believe in him, but they did not appreciate the depth of knowledge that he had, that he knew that Yusuf was alive. For all of these years, he never gave up hope in Allah. He put his trust in Allah that my son is still alive. And when the news comes back and Yusuf alayhi salam's story is told, remember all the brothers would have told him now what happened. He said, didn't I tell you that I know from Allah what you do not know? And this also shows us that all knowledge that a person has, it comes from Allah, not from any person himself. And there are those people now who believe that certain human beings possess knowledge of everything. And this is something that the Quran clearly denies. Rather, it is the prophets who possess more knowledge, but not even ultimate knowledge. Because the Prophet Ya'qub did not know where Yusuf was. The Prophet Ya'qub did not know the details. All he knew, his son is alive. And he put his trust in Allah in that. The point I'm trying to stress here, if the Prophet Ya'qub, and he is such a great prophet, did not know the knowledge of the unseen, all of it, then how could any other human being in our times claim? How could any scholar or any person who believes that he has knowledge other than what is found in the Quran and Sunnah claim he has knowledge of the unseen? These are things that we as Muslims do not believe. True Orthodox Islam does not make gods out of men. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows ilm al-ghayb. Anybody who claims that he knows ilm al-ghayb is simply lying. No one knows ilm al-ghayb other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Prophet Ya'qub tells them, I knew from Allah things that you didn't know. And of the things I knew, that Yusuf is alive. قَالُوا يَا أَبَانَا. They said, O our father, استغفر لنا ذنوبنا. Seek Allah's forgiveness for us. استغفر لنا ذنوبنا إِنَّا كُنَّا خَاطِئِينَ. We were of those who made a mistake. We admit our mistake. So they all beg and plead their father for forgiveness. And they also ask him to ask Allah for forgiveness. So they realize the error of their ways. They realize the big mistake that they had committed. And they had to ask forgiveness from Yusuf, from their father, and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So because their father was a prophet, they go to their father and they say, oh, our father, ask Allah to forgive us. استغفر لنا ذنوبنا إنا كنا خاطئين. And the reply is, قَالَ سَوْفَ أَسْتَغْفِرُ لَكُمْ رَبِّي. He says, سَوْفَ, after a while, after some time, I will seek forgiveness from Allah for your sins. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. He is the one who is the most forgiving and the most merciful. Now, why did he delay the seeking of forgiveness? What was the reason for delaying it? Some scholars say that he wanted to delay it until the last third of the night. And the last third of the night is the time which is the most blessed and the most opportune time to have your dua accepted. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself descends into the lowest heavens. He comes down himself into the lowest heavens and he asks, who is there that is praying to me that I may accept that prayer? Who is there that is making dua that I may give him what he wants? Who is there that is requesting something that I may fulfill his requests? So this occurs in the last third of the night, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down himself and he asks, who is there that's praying to me? We're talking about the night prayer, the tahajjud prayer. So they say that the Prophet Ya'qub alayhi salam wanted to delay asking for their forgiveness up until the last third of the night. And he says, إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-ghafoor and al-rahim. Al-ghafoor means the one who covers up the sin, the one who conceals it and protects you from the consequences of the sin. This is the meaning of al-ghafoor, that the protector or the coverer of the sin, so that the consequences of the sin do not return back to you. This is the actual meaning of ghafoor. Not just forgiving, that's a bit vague. But the actual meaning of ghafoor, you have a sin and Allah protects you from the consequences of your own sin. And Ar-Rahim means that Allah has mercy and compassion. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala combines between these two, Ghafoor Ar-Rahim, in many, many verses in the Quran to show you that the reason why He protects these sins and covers them up is because He is compassionate and merciful. Now, before we conclude today's episode, I want to talk about a little bit of a tangent. And that is the concept of asking someone to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they say over here, O our Father, ask Allah to forgive us. So they themselves obviously have asked Allah for forgiveness, and they have asked Yusuf and their fathers for direct forgiveness for the crimes they've done against them. But here they ask Ya'qub, they say, O our Father, ask Allah for forgiveness. This leads us into a theological tangent. Can you go through intermediaries to get to Allah? And the response to this is no, you cannot. You are not allowed to go through intermediaries to get to Allah. But you are allowed only one thing. And that is, you may ask another living person who is alive, who is in front of you, who is physically present, you may ask that person to make dua for you, to seek forgiveness for you. But you cannot ask a living or a dead person to forgive a sin between you and Allah, or to give you life or child or health or wealth. You cannot ask a living person for dua that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worthy of asking. Nor can you ask a dead person. You cannot ask a saint or an intermediary. You cannot go to the grave of a pious person and say, oh so-and-so, make dua to Allah for forgive me. Or much worse, oh so-and-so, forgive me. Oh so-and-so, give me a child. To do this is blatant shirk. To ask a dead person for something that only Allah can give you, this is blatant shirk. You are making this person into a god besides Allah. Rather, what the children of Ya'qub did, they asked him to ask Allah for forgiveness. And they're allowed to do this especially because Ya'qub is a prophet. And even in our times, if you find a person that you believe is more righteous and pious than you, then along with your own dua, and along with your own efforts, if you go to this person and you say, O Shaykh so-and-so, O Imam so-and-so, can you make dua to Allah to forgive me or to give me a child or this and that? This is permissible. Because you have asked him as a living, healthy person who can hear you, who knows what you're saying, to raise his hands and say, O Allah, forgive this man. O Allah, give him what he wants. And the Sahaba used to do this. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ used to do this with the Prophet ﷺ while he was alive. But after the Prophet ﷺ passed away, they never went to his grave. They never talked to him as he's in the grave. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, do this and do that. Because they realized that he is now alive in the life of the barzakh, not the life of this world. The Prophet ﷺ is alive. Nobody's denying that. But the life that he has is not the life that we have. It is a different type of life. So this is a theological point that I wanted to emphasize because of this verse where they go to their fathers and they say, oh, our father, ask Allah to forgive us. This is permissible only for a living person. Inshallah ta'ala, in our next episode, we will talk about the family reunion that occurred in Egypt with the Prophet Yusuf and the brothers and the parents. Inshallah ta'ala, I hope to see you then. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب. ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.